Hey there, I'm Crystal Beasley. Today I'll be talking about what's all this embodied reality all about anyway? What is she on about? With the rapid hardware advances, full body motion capture is coming really soon. So what's that gonna mean for the future of VR? I can tell you for sure, it's the key to unlocking the full potential of what we can do with VR as a medium. This is the 101. La, la, la. The term embodiment simply means how the brain processes the sensory information that the body perceives. We typically think of the brain telling the body what to do, but the latest research shows that the body also tells the brain what to do.
How can you be so sure?
That research into embodiment points the way for what virtual reality will become as a medium. VR is not a movie, VR is not a game, but it's its own thing altogether. Because VR uses the entire body, not just two hands holding onto some controllers. This episode lays out the seven elements of building intense, embodied experiences in VR. This is a framework for you to level up the fun. Note, they're not in order of any significance or importance, but I have grouped the ones that are related together. Okay, y'all, here's where things get personal. But I can't do justice to why this topic is so important to me if you don't know where I'm coming from. Hold on tight, here goes. From age 15 to 25, I experience intense embodied experiences on a regular basis, specifically speaking in tongues. Yep, I really did that for a decade. It was the spark that set me on a lifelong inquiry into what profound experience was, and even more importantly, how you reproduce it. What I can tell you is that it was a very intense experience that left me feeling washed clean. It's hard to put into words, but for lack of them, it felt like a first rain after a drought. For the last decade, I've observed and sometimes experienced for myself how cultures across the globe systematically induce them. Some of those involve drugs, but for the purposes of this show, I'll be excluding those from this inquiry. I got really excited about VR because it has the potential to create intense embodied experiences. The brain treats whatever environment you build in VR as real. I fully believe it's possible to build a virtual reality speaking in tongues experience. For real, y'all. Don't worry, you don't have to be a believer to speak in tongues. But what you do need is the kind of sensory stimulation that the church provided. My decade of study has led me to conclude that there are seven powerful elements to creating an intense embodied experience. Body pose, motion, of which gesture is a component, intensity of exertion, sound, both hearing and producing, synchronization, touch, and breath. I see ways for VR to engage in all of these pretty convincingly. Well, I'll accept touch. It's the element that's most limited by current technology. We are a long ways away from having hardware which can make it feel like another human has rested their palm on your forehead. I don't, however, believe the lack of high-fidelity touch sensations should dissuade us from exploring what the other elements can do. By way of talking about how each of these elements function, let's choose the concrete example that I know the best, speaking in tongues. It employs all seven elements. Let's unpeel the layers one at a time to understand how they add up to an intense embodied experience. Pose. It's no accident that the both knees bent prostration pose is significant in every culture. In many religions around the world, this is the prayer pose. Fold at the waist a bit further and you have the child's pose in yoga, which is associated with restfulness and reconnection. We all spent the first 9 months of our lives from embryo to birth folded at the knees and the waist. The fetal position is what we instinctively do when we're severely injured. I don't think it's a stretch to say this is the most fundamental human pose. The next component on the list is body motion. Speaking in tongues has three phases of intensity, each with a different corresponding body motion. In the first phase, singing, seekers clap their hands and sway along with the music. The second phase is marked by the crowd's emotions intensifying And you can tell that's happening when the seekers stop clapping and switch to raising their hands in the air. In the final phase, when seekers are speaking in tongues, their motions can take a whole bunch of different forms, from a calm little kneel, all the way up to dancing ecstatically, or running around and jumping. The most intense embodied experiences of speaking in tongues involves feats of exertion and endurance. Holding your hands in the air for possibly hours on end is tough. Dancing in the spirit, running, and jumping are all physical exercise in a very real way. Sound. Merely listening to a song can change your mood. If you've ever gotten euphoric singing at the top of your lungs, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
You want to scream from the bowels of your lungs. The bowels!
If you're frustrated and frantic, start with music that matches that mood. Say some Babymetal. Then shift the music to match your desired mood. Maybe some Tycho chill music. A skilled song leader in the church is exceptionally good at reading the mood of the crowd and choosing songs that resonate, then gradually shifting that mood more and more intense. DJs do exactly the same thing, reading the crowd and nudging them into the mood they choose with the selection of music. Singing songs is even more powerful than merely listening. Sync. The rhythm of songs makes it easy for the crowd to all clap and sway in sync with the beat. Their motions are also in sync with each other. Synchronization of your actions with the crowd activates mirror neurons in your brain, which intensifies the experience. Think about the places you've been in sync with a crowd. Perhaps you've done the wave at a baseball game or a chicken dance at a wedding. An activity that would make you feel nothing but awed if done individually can be super fun when done in a crowd. Breath. Singing causes you to breathe more deeply and push that breath out over a longer time period. Rhythmic, regular, deep breaths add to the intensity of the experience. Touch. Laying on of hands is what my former religion called their mode of engaging the touch element. When a seeker wanted the support of the group, they would go to the altar at the front of the church. Invariably, a group would form around them to support them. They would form a tight knot. The closer people are in proximity, the more intense the experience. Not all touch is equal. The supporters generally start by laying their hands on the less intimate parts of the body, say the seeker's back or arms. They might help hold up the seeker's hands. As the mood deepens, supporters will put their hands on the seeker's forehead. It's not something we usually do in Western culture, but it's a strangely intimate and comforting thing to have someone touch your face. It's as intimate, though not in a sexual way, as being touched on your inner thigh. Again, I see no immediate ways to duplicate this in VR, but I'm including it here for completeness. So that's all seven. I've introduced the elements through the lens of one very particular embodied experience, speaking in tongues. This embodied experience is but one of many. There's an entire world's worth of experiences like this. This show will dissect, catalog, and document the fundamental elements of creating embodied experiences.
You have given me nothing but empty promises.
Brains and bodies are capable of doing some amazing things. In the same way that foods which layer more flavors together are more delicious, experiences which layer more elements of embodiment are more intense and compelling. I literally could not be more thrilled to embark on this expedition into the body and brain with you all. Check out our previous episode, which goes deeper into the neuroscience of embodiment, Body as VR Controller. VR isn't games, and it's not movies either. If we merely use VR to recreate Halo and horror movies, we will have failed, and the medium will fail. Understanding how to use the entire body in VR is the key to realizing the full potential of this new medium. Please let me know how this is important to the experiences you're building. Hit me up in the comments below or on Twitter at Crystal D. Beasley with questions or ideas for future shows. Till next time, I'm Crystal Beasley, and this has been Embodied Reality. Everything's okay. Everything's okay.